First of all, I want to solidify you in the fact that God has a church. Are you with me, saying? So I want to do a little bit of just letting you know that God has a church. Look what the prophet says. She says, has God no living church? He has a church, but it is the church militant, not the church triumphant. Because the Bible tells us that Satan went to make war with the remnant of the seed which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. One of the main factions, or one of the main ways that Satan has caused that God's church to be militant is because he has brought tares into God's church. And unfortunately, brothers and sisters, unfortunately, the majority of the members of the Seventh-day Adventist church today are tares. Because we are told that the majority is going to give up and keep sinning. So that means the majority are tares. It's a simple fact. All right? We are sorry that there are defective members, that there are tares amidst the wheat. Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men, what? Slept. His enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. So Ellen G. White brings out that this sleep was a spiritual sleep. That we went to sleep spiritually. And as a result, Satan was able to bring tares into the church. All right, we're going to move on from that quote, but I want you to mark as Testimonies to Ministers, page 45. All right, let's go. Let's read this part. God is leading out a people. He has a chosen people, a church on earth, whom he has made the depositories of his law. He has committed to them sacred trust and eternal truths to be given to the world. Skipping down. The message, come on, let's read this. I want us to get this. The message to pronounce the Seventh-day Adventist Church Babylon and call the people of God out of her does not come from any heavenly messenger or any human agent inspired by the Spirit of God. Are you with me, saints?
Yes.
So if someone comes to you telling you to leave this church, that this church is babbling, and you need to get out of here in order to be saved, you know that's of the devil. Yes. This is God's church. In spite of all you see that you're going to see, this is God's church. Are you with me, saints?
Yes.
What you see going on in it is the result of what Satan is making war against this church.
Right.
All right, let's go. I want to make sure you got that. Because see, the things we've been sharing with you, I don't want you to become meat for every beast of the field. Because see, Satan's gonna send through beasts now. We can't let them go back and understand this thing. So I want you to understand, Satan. She says, the Father loves his people today as he loved his own son. Someday it will be our privilege to see him face to face. Look here. Let's read this part. We should remember that the church, enfeebled and defective though it be, is the only object on earth on which Christ bestows his supreme regard. He is constantly watching it with solicitude and is spinning it by his Holy Spirit. Another place she says the church would appear as about to fall, but it does not fall. It will remain while the sinners in Zion is shaken out. So I want us to make sure we understand that this church is God's church. It is definitely in trouble. Satan is doing everything he can to bring it down. And that's what we've been talking about, right? And what the message that God has brought us here to give you is that we need a message that will prepare us to stand. When this investigative judgment passes from the dead to the living. Now, many of you have asked some questions about, well, why isn't the church talking about this investigative judgment? We're going to show you just briefly. We're going to show you. Let's let you see how effective Satan has been. We're going to show you in just a minute here. You ever heard of this woman here? Who is that? Hulda. Tell me about Hulda. She is a prophetess. I like that. Prophetess. Let's go in our Bibles. Let's go in our Bibles to 2 Chronicles. Like I said, I'm giving you two. Well, first of all, I'll tell you what let's do. Let's go over to Deuteronomy. Before we go to 2 Chronicles, let's go to Deuteronomy. Going to Deuteronomy chapter 7 again. The Bible says in Deuteronomy chapter 7, we're going to go down to verse 6. We're going to study together here for about an hour and 15 minutes, and then we're going to call it quits. Can you handle that? Can you handle an hour and 15 minutes?
Yes.
All right, let's go. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6, the Bible says, for thou art what? Holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. Let's look at verse 7, saints. The Lord did not set his love upon you, nor chose you because ye were more in number than any people, for ye were the what? Fewest of people. Now let's go over to chapter 12. In chapter 12, the Bible says, chapter 12, verse 11, the Bible says, and let's look at verse 11, chapter 12, verse 11. Then there shall be a place which the Lord your God shall choose to cause his name to dwell there. Neither shall ye do what? Bring all that I command you, your burnt offerings and your sacrifices, your tithes, and the heave offerings of your hand, and all your choice vows which you have vowed unto the Lord. So God chose his people. He says, listen, don't make any alliances with them. He says, you are a holy people. And he says, I'm choosing you and choosing a city to put my name in there. He says, I'm taking you to the land of Canaan, which is a type of heaven. And he says, listen, don't make any alliances. Don't worship the idols. Don't do any of that thing. Now, let's go over to Judges. Let's go over to Judges. I want to put all this together, saints. Let's go to Judges. Judges chapter 2. We're walking through now. Judges chapter 2. Here they have gotten into Canaan land. The people have gotten into Canaan land. And you remember, everybody that was 20 years old and older had to die in the wilderness. Is that right, brothers and sisters? Remember that? So they got into Canaan land. I made the point this morning that when they got into Canaan land, the oldest person was how old? 60 years old. All right, let's look at it, saints. Let's look at it. And when Joshua had let the people go, the children of Israel went every man unto his inheritance to do what? Verse 7. And the people did, come on, let's read this thing, saints. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders that outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord that he had did for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died being 110 years old. Now, while Joshua was alive, the people served the Lord. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? While Joshua was alive, the people served the Lord. Watch it now, saints. Verse 9, and they buried him in the border of his inheritance in Timnathheres in the Mount of Ephraim on the north side of the hill Gaash, and also all that generation were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation after them which knew not the Lord nor the works which he had done for Israel. Tell me something about the fifth generation, brothers and sisters. They don't know the Lord. They don't know anything about what has happened in the first and the second generation. They don't know anything about it, brothers and sisters. Are you with me, saints? Are you following it? Look at this thing now. All right. Now, what did they do? Verse 11. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served who? Balaam. Verse 12. Let's read it together, saints. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, which brought them out of the land of Egypt, and followed other gods of the gods of the people that were round about them, and did what, saints? Bowed themselves unto them, and provoke the Lord to anger. Now, thanks for what we've got to do here. We've got to find out who are these gods that the other nations were serving. Because we found out that God's people went and did the same thing that they were doing. Are you with me, saying? So let's look at verse 13 and see who up. Let's read it. Are we there? The Bible says, and they forsook the Lord and served who? Baal and Ashtaroth. Now we know who Baal is, right? Baal is Nimrod, Ashtaroth is Semiramis. This is where we get Easter, the sun, Christmas, and all of this Easter egg, all of this false worship, the high places, all of this. That's where it comes from right here. Now I want us to get here. Now remember, the children of Israel came out of Egypt in 1445. They arrived in Canaan land in 1405. Now we're going to go from 1405 all the way down to 605. Are you with me, saying? That's 800 years. So as we are approaching 605, we want to go to 2 Kings. We're going to 2 Kings chapter 21. The Bible says. And we're way down the road now. We actually, 2 Kings, Manasseh is on the scene. And he rules the northern kingdom for 55 years. Let's see, what did Manasseh do? In 2 Kings 21, verses 1, the Bible says, Manasseh was what? 12 years old. When he began to reign, and he reigned how long? 55 years in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Zibbah. What did he do? And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord after the abominations of the heathen whom the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. So here we see Manasseh is doing the abominations of the heathen. You ever heard of the abomination of desolation? Yes. All right, get this now. Get this. He did after the abominations of the heathens. What were the heathens doing? Verse 3. For he built up again the high places. That's where the orgies are going on, which Hezekiah his father had destroyed. And he reared up altars for who? Yes. That's Nimrod, that's sun worship. That's sun worship. Y'all, you with me, brothers and sisters? That's sun worship. Remember when Nimrod died, Semiramis said that he had gone to the sun. Then she got pregnant, and she says her sun god husband had overshadowed her with a sunbeam, and that thing in her was holy, and that thing was born December 25th, and his name was Tammuz. This is history, brothers and sisters. So here we see that God's people is worshiping Baal. They actually reared up altars for Baal. Look what it says, saints. And he reared up altars for Baal and made a grove, as did Ahab, king of Israel, and did, what else did he do, saint? Worship all the hosts of heaven and serve them. Look at verse 4, saints. Now remember, God chose a place to put his name, right? Where did he put his name? In the sanctuary. In the sanctuary. All right. Where in the sanctuary? Okay, he put his name in Jerusalem. Where? In the Ark of the Covenant. In what? In the law. Okay, now look at it now. Look at it. Verse 4. And he built altars where? Of which the Lord said, in Jerusalem will I put my name. This is total abomination. Verse 5 says, and he built altars for all the host of heaven in what? In the two courts of the house of the Lord. Verse 6, what did he do, saints? And he made his son pass through the fire and observed times and used enchantments and dealt with familiar spirits and wizards. He wrought much wickedness in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. They were into astrology because astrology came from the plains of Shinar. Astrology was no... All pagan religions come out of astrology. The pagans had this chart, had 36 numbers in it because they had gone up and mapped the heavens, and they had 36 numbers in it. Any way you add up the numbers in that chart, you come up with 111. Six times 111 is what? That's where your 666 come from. So when you get over to Revelation, it says this number 666. It is simply telling you that this power in Revelation is still carrying on this same religious system that was formed by Nimrod at the Tower of Babel. That's all I was telling you, brothers and sisters. We don't have time to go into all of that, though. All right, let's go now. Here we are at Manasseh. Now, Manasseh, and all he did, the boy repented. L.J. White said he was saved. But look how many people was lost as a result. But when he passed off the scene, his son Ammon came on the scene. And his son Ammon ruled for 2 years and did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord also. But Ammon passed off the scene, and a man by the name of Josiah came on the scene. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now, I'm going to tell you something. We have the anti-typical Josiah in the White House, right? I mean, not in the White House. In General Conference right now. He's anti-typical Josiah. He has not yet found the book of the law. He did some reforms. He came on doing reforms. Josiah came on the scene doing reforms. Let's look at it. Now, I'm going to go over to 2 Chronicles to read about it. Because, see, 2 Chronicles and 2 Kings are parallel books. You just get different information from both of them, but it's the same book, same information. In 2 Chronicles 34, the Bible says, Josiah was how old, saints? 8 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned in Jerusalem one and 30 years. He started reigning in 640 and reigned down to 609, and he did that which was what, saints? Right in the sight of the Lord, and walked in the ways of David his father, and declined neither to the right hand nor to the left. But in the 8th year of his reign, while he was yet young, he began to seek after the God of David his father. And in the 12th year, he began to purge Judah and Jerusalem from the high places and the groves and the carved images and the molten images. So here we see Josiah coming on the scene, and he wants to do the right thing. Now, Jeremiah is a contemporary of Josiah. Jeremiah becomes a prophet in 627. All right, are you following me, brothers and sisters? Josiah goes throughout all the land, and he purges the land of all the high places, all the groves, all of this pagan worship that they're going on. And then he comes back to Jerusalem, and remember now, the temple is laying desecrated. And Josiah says, I'm going to repair the temple, and we're going to start the true worship of God again. And he called for his helpers. I'm rushing through this a little bit, but I want to get to a point. Let's go to 34 verses 13. Let's start at verse 8 just a minute. Now in the 18th year of his reign, when he had purged the land and the house, he sent Shaphan, the son of Azaliah, and Manasseh, the governor of the city, and Jonah, the son of Jochaz, the recorder, to do what? Repair the house of the Lord his God. Let's skip down now to verse 13. Also they were over the bearers of burdens and were overseers over all that wrought the work in any manner of service, and of the Levites there were scribes and officers and porters. Verse 14, let's read together. And when they brought out the money that was brought into the house of the Lord, Hilkiah the priest found a book of the law of the Lord given by Moses. Now, brothers and sisters, I don't have time to go into all the details there. But when Moses was writing in Deuteronomy, he says, take this book of the law and put it in the side of the ark. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now, on the inside of the ark was the Ten Commandments. But there was a book of the law in a pocket on the side of the ark. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now, if you broke the Ten Commandments, if you sinned, you had to go to the book of the law and find out what to do about it. Are you with me, saying? Now, also, the book of the law told you how you were to eat. It told you how you were to drink. It told you how you were to dress. It told you how you were to carry on your religious services. It told the Israelites everything they needed to do in order to not offend God. What's the antitype of the book of the law? Come on, talk to me. Come on, talk to me. It was the spirit of prophecy, my brother. I don't have time to go into all the details and not to show you, but it's exactly what it was. It was the spirit of prophecy. It was written by Moses, brothers and sisters. And Moses was the prophet that God used to bring the children out of Egypt. And Ellen G. White was the prophet that God used to bring us out of sin. Are you with me, saying? It was the spirit of prophecy. And it was in a side of the pocket. And the priest had to have one. And the king himself had to have a copy of this book. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now, Let's continue here. Let's go over to 2 Chronicles. We're still in 2 Chronicles 36. Let's look at verse 18 now. And remember now, Josiah's done all these reforms. Then Shaphan, are you with me, saints? Then Shaphan, in 34:18, then Shaphan, the scribe, told the king, saying, Hilkiah, the priest, has given me a book, giving him a great controversy. Gave him Testimonies, Volume 5, 172. Gave him the book Education. You're not hearing me, brothers and sisters. Gave him Fundamentals of Christian Education. Are you hearing me, saying? Gave me a book. And Shaphan read it before the king. Let me see here. Read it before the king. And the king commanded Hilkiah. Wait a minute, verse 19. And it came to pass when the king had heard the words of the law that he did what? As you've been hearing these truths this week, brother and sister, you thought you was all right. Look here. Josiah thought he was all right. He's done good. But as you've been hearing these things this week, how far we off the mark. And where were they found? In the Bible, the spirit of prophecy. And we didn't even know they were there. And so when Josiah heard all of these things, he rent his clothes, because in Deuteronomy, God had already said, if you do what I say do, you're going to be blessed. It says you're going to be hemmed up with blessing. You're going to be blessed in the field. You're going to be blessed at home. Everything you do is going to be a blessing. He said, but if you don't do them, you're going to be under a curse. And so when Josiah heard what was in this book, he said, we are under a curse. We are under a curse. And he rent his clothes. Look what it says. Look what he says. And the king commanded Hilkiah and Ahakim, the son of Shaphan, and Adon, the son of Micah, and Shaphan, the scribe, and Asaiah, a servant of the king, saying, let's read it together, verse 21. Go inquire of the Lord for me and for them that are left in Israel and in Judah concerning the words of the book that is found. For great is the wrath of the Lord that is poured out upon us because what? Don't miss that. What? Have not done what? All that is written in this book. Brothers and sisters, you and I have come on the scene as Seventh-day Adventists. We have been brought in under this watered-down juice, and we don't even know that our fathers have been mesmerized, have been bamboozled to give up the very things that's supposed to represent Seventh-day Adventism. We come on the scene, brothers and sisters, the juice has been watered down, and we're drinking and thinking we're all right. We're eating anything we want. We're dressing anything. We're watching television. We're going where we want to do. We're doing just whatever we want to. And we don't know that our fathers have cast this truth to the side. It's been a systematic casting of this truth to the side. And then now when you hear this, you go, whoa! What? Look here. They sent to who though? Let me back it up. She says, through Huldah, the Lord sent Josiah word that Jerusalem's ruin could not be averted. In the words, at this time, it's 800 years into this apostasy. At this time, it cannot be averted. When I read this from the Bible, I said, wait a minute, what does this mean? So let me go and see what the spirit of prophecy has to say. She says, Jerusalem's ruin cannot be averted. Even should the people now humble themselves before God, they could not escape their punishment. Wait a minute, saint. So long had their senses been deadened by wrongdoing that if judgment should not come upon them, they would soon return to the same sinful course. Because saints, for 800 years they've been doing this. They would, listen, God would deliver them. And as soon as they get delivered, they'd go back into apostasy again. God would cause some more trouble to come upon them. Some enemy would come and capture them. And they would get in capture. And then they would plead with God, Lord, if you get us out of this, we're going to straighten up. Lord would get them out. They were straightened up for a minute, and then they go right back doing the same thing. 800 years of this. God says, okay, you have reached your limit. And we're going to see what this limit is, brothers and sisters. We need to see what this limit is this evening. And Brother Davis talked about this limit. We're going to see what the final limit is for us. Look what she says. Tell the man that sent you to me, the prophet declared, thus said the Lord, behold, I will bring evil upon this place and upon the inhabitants thereof. Even all the words of the book which the king of Judah hath read, because they have done what? They have forsaken me and have burned incense unto other gods, that they might provoke me to anger with all the works of their hands. Therefore my wrath shall be kindled against this place and shall not be quenched. God says, listen, there's no hope. He says, Josiah tells Josiah, I'm not going to let it happen on your watch, is what he says, what you continue reading in the Bible. He says, I'm not going to let it happen on your watch. He says, but as soon as you pass off the scene, it's coming. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now, God told Josiah, even Josiah, which was a good king, he said, look, you're going to go to your grave in peace. But Josiah himself got bullheaded and went out against Necho, and he met an untimely death. But as soon as he died, let's see what happens. Josiah dies now. Let's go to 2 Chronicles 36. Are we there, saints? She says there's no remedy. Josiah 36, the Bible says, then the people of the land took Jehoahaz, the son of Josiah, and made him king in his father's stead in Jerusalem. And Jehoahaz was 23 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 3 months in Jerusalem. I'm in 2 Chronicles 36. And the king of Egypt put him down at Jerusalem and condemned the land in 100 talents of silver and 1,000 of gold. And the king of Egypt made Eliakim, his brother, king over Judah and Jerusalem, and turned his name to Jehoiakim. And Necho took Jehoahaz, his brother, and carried him to Egypt. Now, Necho comes down. He says, listen, I have no fight with you, but Josiah came out against him. So he killed him. The archers slew Josiah, and now Necho put Jerusalem under tribute. And as he put him under tribute, he set up Jehoiakim as the king. Let's read verse 5. Jehoiakim was what? 25 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned 11 years in Jerusalem, and he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord. Now, he reigned from 608 until 597. While he was reigning, Nebuchadnezzar came on the scene, the king from the north, and he comes down, and he beats up on Necho, and he comes up to Jerusalem, and he tells Jehoiakim, listen, you all can still function as a state or as a city or as a country or what have you. He says, I just want you to send me your tribute money to me. And then he brings in all of the young children there that were smart. And who you think they brought in? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. This is a long story. I'm running through it tonight. I know I'm going to take an hour to go through this. I'm just going to give you some tidbits here because we're going someplace. He brings them in, and he takes them with him down to Babylon. So when you read Daniel chapter 1, Nebuchadnezzar has just left Jerusalem. Are you with me, saints? So he takes them down there. But what do Jehoiakim do? He rebels against Nebuchadnezzar. And Nebuchadnezzar comes back the second time. He comes the first time in 605. He comes back again in 597. Now, Nebuchadnezzar is angry this time because he did the Jews nice the first time. But when he comes back, he's angry. Now, he comes back the next time. He takes some more stuff out of the temple. He beats down some of the walls so they can't rebel again. And this time, he takes 10,000 captive. And guess who goes into second captivity? Ezekiel goes into second captivity. So Ezekiel goes down to Babylon in 597. And 5 years later, Ezekiel is called into the prophetic office. So when you read the book of Ezekiel, you're reading him from the geographical position of Babylon down on the river Shebar. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? And now watch it. Now watch what's going to happen. Watch it. We're going somewhere with this. The Bible says, verse 7, Nebuchadnezzar also carried of the vessels of the house of the Lord to Babylon and put them in his temple at Babylon. Now the rest of the acts of Jehoiakim and his abominations which he did, and that which was found in him, behold, they are written in the book of the kings of Israel and Judah, and Jehoiachin, his son, reigned in his stead. Jehoiachin was 8 years old when he began to reign. He only reigned 3 months. We're going to skip on past him. Verse 11. Zedekiah was 120 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned how long?
11 years.
He reigned 11 years. He reigned to 586. That's when Nebuchadnezzar came back for the last time. And when he came back the last time, he was really mad. He came in 588. He starved him for 2 years and finally broke up the city in 586. And that's when he destroyed the city. That's when Solomon's temple was found desolate. All right, look what it says. Verse 12. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, his God, and humbled not himself before Jeremiah the prophet, speaking from the mouth of the Lord. And he also rebelled against King Nebuchadnezzar, who had made him swear by God, but he stiffened his neck and hardened his heart from turning unto the Lord God of Israel. Moreover, look at verse 14, says, let's read it. Moreover, all the chief of the priests and the people transgressed very much after who? All the abominations and heathens, and did what, saints? Polluted the house of the Lord, which he had hallowed in Jerusalem. Now, saints, you better get this. All the people did after all the abominations of the heathens round about them. All the heathens, brothers and sisters, was dressing like they wanted, eating what they want. As Brother David just talked about, all the heathens had on rings and jewelry and had their bodies all cut up in their Easter eggs and everything. They polluted the drums was in the churches and in the heathen temples and everything. Singing, swinging, celebrating, everything was in their temples. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? The Bible says that the people polluted the house of the Lord, which he had hallowed in Jerusalem. Verse 15, now let's look at it. And the Lord God of their fathers sent to them by his messengers, rising up betimes and sinning. Because what? And on his dwelling place. God right now is sending messengers. He just sent a message to Jamaica, brothers and sisters. He just sent a message to you. Are you hearing me, saints? Watch it now. What did they do? Verse 16. See, you got to write this prophecy. What does it say? But they mocked the messengers of God and despised his word. Brothers and sisters, you don't want to be one of those that's mocking this message. And misused his prophets. Listen to this thing, saints. Until the wrath of the Lord arose against his people, till there was no remedy. Now, brothers and sisters, this is what we've got to find out here this evening. When there was no remedy, God sent Nebuchadnezzar back for the last time, and that's when he burned the city down. Now, what you and I need to find out, what did these people do that would cause God to say there is no remedy? Are you with me, saints? Because, see, this is a type and a type. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? So what did they do that God would say there is no remedy? Now, in order for us to find out, we've got to go to Ezekiel. Remember, Ezekiel now and 2 Chronicles is type and a type. They're saying the same thing. So let's go to Ezekiel, the 8th chapter. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Ezekiel chapter 8. Ezekiel is called into the prophetic office in 592. So Ezekiel is down in Babylon, and God takes him and put him in vision and takes him back down to Jerusalem before the final siege. Are you with me, saints? The Bible says in verse 8, and it came to pass in the sixth year, in the sixth month, in the fifth day of the month, as I sat in mine house, and the elders of Judah sat before me, that the hand of the Lord God fell there upon me. Then I beheld, and lo, a likeness as the appearance of fire, from the appearance of his lounge, even downward fire, and from his lounge even upward, as the appearance of brightness, as the color of armor. Verse 3, and he put forth the form of a hand, and he took me by a lock of mine head, and the Spirit lifted me up between the earth and the heavens. Where did he take him, saints? He brought me where? Into the visions of Jerusalem. So he is in Babylon, but God takes him in vision back down to Jerusalem. He says, Ezekiel, I want you to see what is going on down there. Now, brothers and sisters, hear me. What Ezekiel sees is for you and I. Because in 2 Chronicles, we are getting the literal application, but Ezekiel is giving us the spiritual application for the last days. And you're going to see this. Just hold on. You're going to see the literal application. The physical, I mean the spiritual application. Verse 4 says, and behold, the glory of the God of Israel was there according to the vision that I saw in the plain. Now, come on, saints, talk to me. If the glory of God was there, where was he? In the temple. Where in the temple? He was in the most holy place. Now, All kind of foolishness is going on down there. But God had left. Come on now, saints, you better get this. Remember I told you that the church in feeble and effective and needing reproof, it is still the only object upon which God, this earth which God bestows his supreme regard. So Ezekiel, all everything is going on down there, but when Ezekiel get down there and vision, God is still there. The glory of God is still there. Are you with me, saints? He hadn't told, he didn't tell Ezekiel, go down and tell him, go John 25:20. Come on, talk to me. The glory of God was there. And he said, listen. Then said unto me, son of man, lift up thine eyes now on the way toward the north. So I lifted mine eyes the way toward the north, and behold, northward at the gate of the altar, this image of jealousy in the entrance. So here, the Jews, the Israelites, had set up in front of God's sanctuary an obelisk. You know that thing that's set up in, that's sitting in St. Peter's Basilica? That obelisk, the one that's sitting in Washington? Well, this is a pagan symbol of sun worship. The obelisk represents the phallus. It represents the male organ. That's reading in 1582, I believe, that the Pope of that time had the workmen there in Rome to move the obelisk so when the sun hit it, it would cast a shadow through the doors of St. Peter's Basilica because it represents sex. Are you with me, brother? So this happens in history. So the obelisk represents sun worship. And so God's people had set up an obelisk in front of the sanctuary. Like the heathens. Are you with me, saying? And God calls it an image of jealousy. Let's continue. He said furthermore unto me, son of man, seest thou what they do, even the great abomination that the house of Israel committed here, that I should go forth from my sanctuary? But turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see what? He says, I'm going to show you something worse than this. But saints, remember, what he's showing Ezekiel, he's showing to you and I. Because what you're reading here is an end time prophecy. Are you with me, saints? And he brought me to the door of the court, and when I looked, behold, a hole in the wall. Then said he unto me, son of man, dig now in the wall. And when I had dug in the wall, behold, a door. And he said unto me, go in and behold the wicked abomination that they do here. So I went in. And saw and behold every form of creeping thing and abominable beasts and all the idols of the house of Israel portrayed upon the wall round about. And Ezekiel is seeing all these things going on. You can see Ezekiel saying, oh my gosh, Lord, they're not doing that. And God is saying, I'm going to show you something worse than this. We hear things that's going on in our church today. You hear about all these things. You say, no, they didn't do that. And God is saying, I'm going to show you something worse than this. And all the time that all this is going on, the glory of God is still there. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Yes. Listen to this thing now. Verse 11. It says, and there stood before them 70 men of the ancients of the house of Israel. And in the midst of them stood Jehoiakim, the son of Shaphan, with every man his censer in his hand, and a thick cloud of incense went up. They're burning incense to pagan gods. Verse 12, let's read it, saints. Then said unto me, son of man, hast thou seen what the ancients, this is the elders. Hast thou seen what the ancients of the house of Israel do in the dark, every man in the chamber of his imagery? For they say, the Lord seeth us not, the Lord hath forsaken the earth. Verse 13, let's read it, saints. Here's key. He said also unto me, turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abominations that they do. Can it get any worse? He said, I'm going to show you something worse than this. What's the next thing he shows him? Then he brought me to the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was what? And behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. Who is Tammuz? Now, what did the pagans believe about Tammuz? They believed that he died every year and was resurrected when? No, when was he resurrected? Easter. Now, let me ask you a question, brothers and sisters. Why does Easter not come on the same date every year? Huh? Huh? The solo solace. In other words, Easter have to come on the first Sunday after the first full, after the vernal equinox. Why? Because the sun, the moon, and Venus rise together. Because Nimrod had gone to the sun, Astaroth and Semiramis had gone to the moon, and Tammuz had gone to Venus. And so Easter, after Astar, moves every year. Are you with me? And this was done at the Nicene Council because it's pagan. And so, but before Easter, what do you do? What do the people do today? Huh? What do they do, Saint? 40 days of Lent. And so this is what they're doing here. The women are weeping for Tammuz for 40 days. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Do we have any business involved in this? Yes. Here we are having 40 days of prayer. Why are we praying 365 days? Why just 40? Brothers and sisters, all a part of Satan to bring us into harmony with the rest of the churches. So here the women are, weeping for Tammuz. And as God sees this, what does he say? Then he brought me into the door of the gate of the Lord's house, which was toward the north, and behold, there sat women weeping for Tammuz. Then said he unto me, hast thou seen this, O son of man? Turn thee yet again, and thou shalt see greater abomination than these. Now, wait a minute, brothers and sisters. I want you to get something. We're already doing this. Are we already doing this, brothers and sisters? And God says, I'm going to show you something worse than this. Now why are they weeping for Tammuz? Where is God? Where is God? He's in the most holy place. Now listen now. Listen now. God says, I'm going to show you something worse than this. So now the next thing that God shows Ezekiel is going to have some serious significance for us. Let's read it. Are you ready, saints?
Yes.
Verse 16. And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house. And behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men. Let me tell you something first. The sanctuary was built so that when the children of Israel went in to worship God, they had to turn their back to the sun because, see, sun worship was the main, that's Satan's worship. Sun worship is Satan worship. So the temple was always built so when you went into it, the sun would be to your back. If that was the sun, the temple was built facing that way so when the worshipers went in, their back was to the sun. God wanted to make sure they didn't worship the sun. Well, he told them, look, when you get in the land of Eden, don't you worship the sun, the moon, don't you do that. So when we read here in Ezekiel chapter 8, it says that were about 25 men, in verse 16, with their backs toward what? And their faces toward what? And they worship the sun toward the east. Now, they did this just after they saw them worshiping for Tammuz, right? Let's look at that screen. And he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, and behold, at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, were about 25 men with their backs towards the temple of the Lord and their faces toward the east, and they worshiped the sun toward the east. Watch it now. Remember over in 2 Chronicles, there came a time when there was what?
No remedy.
No remedy. Y'all remember that? In 2 Chronicles, there came a time where there was no remedy. Now watch. Let's see what it says. Verse 17. Then said he unto me, hast thou seen this, O son of man? Is it a light thing to the house of Judah that they commit the abominations which they commit here? For they have filled the land with violence and have returned to provoke me to anger. And lo, they put the branch to their nose. Verse 18. Therefore will I also deal in fury. Mine I shall not spare, neither will I have pity. And though they cry in mine ears with a loud voice, yet will I not hear them. Now let's go to chapter 9. Chapter 9, verses 1. What does it say, saints? Cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which lies toward the north. And every man, what did he have in his hand? A slaughter weapon in his hand. Now get this, brothers. This is over in 2 Chronicles. It says that when Nebuchadnezzar came, he slew utterly old and young, both amazing little children. Here in Ezekiel, it says six men come from the way of the higher gate, and that what they got? Slaughter weapons in their hand. But what about the one man among them? Keep reading. And one man among them had what? What did he have? A writer's ink on by his side. What did it say? So where did they start if they stand by the brazen altar? And where? In the outer court. Thy way, O God. Come on, talk to me. So, one man among them had a writer's ink on by his side. What does he tell the man with the writer's ink to do? And do what? Set a mark upon those crying, cry for what? The abomination that's done therein, and do what? And what he said? And slay utterly old and young, the children. Where are you going to begin? Begin at my sanctuary. Brothers and sisters, before the man with the slaughter weapon can go in, the man with the writer's ink on got to go in. Who is this man with the writer's ink on? What does that represent? Yeah. The seal. So the man with the writer's ink on comes into the church and he begins to set a mark of where? On the forehead. Don't we see, have we been studying that in the very end that there's going to be some people in Revelation with God's name in their forehead? This is the sealing angel, brothers and sisters. And the sealing angel comes into the Seventh-day Adventist church first. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Not the Methodist church. Are you hearing me, brothers and sisters? Not some offshoot group. You better get this thing, brothers and sisters. He's coming into the Seventh-day Adventist church first to do the sealing. What is he going to do the sealing in here for? What is he going to do to see them for, saints? To get a people together to give the loud cry. So if he sealed them, brothers and sisters, that means they are sinless. Do we see this thing, brothers and sisters?
Yes.
You need to write down beside this Testimonies, Volume 3, page 266 to 269, because Ellen G. White tells us this is an end time prophecy. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now look at what it says. Look what it says. I want you to understand, this is God's church. Don't you leave it. Testimonies 3, 266 to 269. Testimonies of Ministers, page 445. It's more, I mean, a whole lot of them, but I'm just give you, I'm rushing, brother and sister, because I want to get someplace else. All right, let's look at this thing. Now look what he says. They stood by the brazen altar. Then they go. Now look at verse 3. We're in chapter 9, verse 3. And what? The glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub. When did God go up from the cherub? Let's read it. And the glory of God was gone up from the cherub, whereupon it was to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with linen, which had the writing's ink on the back side. Now I want you to get the point here, saint. When they turned their back on the temple and faced the east and worshiped sun, that was all God could handle. So now he lifts up from between the cherubim, because he's in the most holy place, right? He's between the cherubims, right? And he goes to the threshold of the door. He don't go out. He goes to the threshold, like you go to your door and you beckon for somebody. He goes to the threshold, like if this is a door, he goes right here. He don't go out. And he beckons for the man with the writing. He said, go in there. I want you to set a mark upon everybody that's sighing and crying for the abomination that's done therein. You go to Testimonies, Volume 5, start on page 206. Let's see. Yeah, 206. The ceiling of God, and you'll find out what this sighing and crying is. It's praying and agonizing, brothers and sisters. Look here. Look what it says now in verse 4. And the Lord said to him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for the abomination that be done in the midst thereof. And to the others he said, in mine hearing, go ye after him through the city and smite, let not your eye spare, neither have you pity, slay old and young, both maids and little children and women. But what, saints? But come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. Now, it is not until God does the sealing in the church that he leaves. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now let's go over to Ezekiel 11. And let's look at verses 22. And I'm going to stop this and we're going to move to something else. The Bible says, then did the cherubims, when Ezekiel 11, verses 22. I think this is what you need this evening to solidify yourself. Because, see, I know the wolves are coming. Even though we're telling you about it, I know the wolves are coming. You need to be able to go to the Bible and show that you need to stay where you are. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? This is God's church. In spite of all this taking place, this is God's church. Don't you leave. Don't you let anybody persuade you to leave this church and go join nothing. This is the seventh church. This is it. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? What we got to do, we need a revival and a reformation in here. All right. Then did the cherubims lift up their wings and the wheels beside them, and the glory of the God of Israel was over them above. Verse 23, let's read together. And the glory of the Lord went up from the midst of the city and stood upon the mountain, which is on the east side of the city. What is the mountain on the east side of Jerusalem? The Mount of Olives. When Jesus said your house is left unto you desolate, he came out of Jerusalem, he went to the Mount of Olives. Same thing, brothers and sisters. Look at this thing. Let's go to our screen. When that happens, brothers and sisters, there's no remedy. Now, what does that represent? Wait a minute. I must then program something in here. I want you to get this. I don't want you to miss this. Too important. I did. Too important. What does that represent, saying? Sun worship. No remedy. What does the sun worship represent for us? Sunday law. Brothers and sisters, when this Sunday law comes and we give up and keep Sunday and we turn on the sanctuary and face the east and keep Sunday, no remedy. The last act of apostasy. Are you with me, saints? The mark of the beast. Do you see, saints, that it's coming to us first? It's not coming to the Methodists. It's not coming to the Presbyterians. It's not coming to the Catholics. It's coming to us first. Why? Because you and I are the people that understand the issue. Those people don't understand the issue now. Actually, they're the ones that are going to pass this Sunday law. And they think they're doing what God wants them to do. You and I are the ones that will know better. And therefore, judgment has to begin with the house of God. Do you understand this thing this evening, brothers and sisters? Enforce Sunday worship. All right, let's go. I got to do something very special this evening. Anybody know who that man is? All right, good. You know who he is. What did we find out earlier? That our fathers have not done all that they should do. All right, I need a mic over here. Give me a mic. I'm going to show you this, and we're going to look at a few more slides, And then we're going to do something to try to help you float out of here. I think you got the picture. All right, let me put it on pause. This is a 2-minute clip of Desmond Ford. Do you all know when he was defrocked from this church?
Yes.
When? 1980. Here he is speaking at the Campus Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church in California, a very, very prominent church in 2008. Now, I want you to, now this is a set of discs I made. I have a few sets of them here. I know I'm gonna get run over with them. But I want you to look at this clip that I put in this DVD series. I want you to listen attentively, brothers and sisters.
Here are all the flags on it. Now, this is, I don't know who this gentleman
can
is.
You hear
this picture is particularly speaking, but I'm going to show you a clip.
Huh? You got something else you're going to do? Huh? That's it. That's where it's going.
This church of the Campus Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church in California. I'm going to show you a clip from 2008 when Desmond Ford was speaking there. Now, you know Desmond Ford was actually defrocked or actually fired from the denomination in 1980. We will talk about that just in a little bit. But here we see here that he's speaking at a very prominent our Seventh-day Adventist Church in California in 2008, which makes it would be 28 years later. And you can see as he's speaking here, he's gotten older. He's 28 years older than he was back in 1980 when he came out, when he was founding this fellowship and what have you. So at this point in time, we're going to take a brief look, just a 2.5-minute clip from his speaking, with some of the things he spoke morning and evening there.
Listen attentively, brothers.
We're going to just take a 2.5-minute clip. Let you look at a 2.5-minute clip of his presentation. It's 2.5 minutes, and it's 22.5 minutes into his presentation for that evening. So we're going to start at 22.5 minutes and go over about 25 minutes and let you just see what Dr. Desmond Ford is saying in a Seventh-day Adventist church, not just any old Seventh-day Adventist church, but a very, very prominent Seventh-day Adventist church, the Campus Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church in California. We're going to run the clip at this time.
Oh, no. Oh, no. Who was this man who on a cross could be as calm as if walking
watch this joker. He is very slick.
Summer pavement and give away heaven. Who was this man?
I'm trying to make out like he believed in the spirit of cross, but he didn't.
Who was this man? He was my savior. He was your savior. The church, Ellen White had it right in Acts of the Apostles, where he said from the beginning of time, all faithful souls are members of the church. New Testament knows nothing about denominations. I, in creedal positions, am very much a Seventh-day Adventist.
He's not a Seventh-day Adventist.
But I'm first a Christian. I'm a member of a church that has no borders.
He said he's a member of a church that has no borders.
That takes in Roman Catholics and Presbyterians.
That's the church he belongs to.
And Methodists. All who love Jesus and believe that he was God's provision in vicarious sacrifice for their sins. All who love Jesus. You say, what? You can include people with all sorts of errors? Well, when I include Adventists, I do that.
Are you all hearing this?
You know, all our teaching of historicism on prophetic themes and setting dates Our scholars have known for decades that's all wrong.
Our scholars have known for decades it's error.
William Miller was a great Christian. God used him to revive the Second Advent premillennial hope. God used him, great man, but not a great scholar.
Watch what he says.
And not even a great mathematician.
Says he wasn't a great mathematician.
And almost all our dates, like 538, 508, 1798, 1844, they all come from Billy Miller. And he's wrong in all of them.
He says he's wrong in all of them.
He's wrong in all of them. There is no evidence of papal supremacy from 538 to 1798. That's just not true.
No evidence.
Ask any historian. There was papal supremacy for 2 to 3 centuries, around the 11th century or so. It's just not true, all we said about 538 to 1798. That's a hangover from Miller.
538 to 1798, not true.
All the stuff we said on the trumpets, French Revolution and Revelation 11, United States and Revelation 13, none of it's correct.
None of it's correct.
When I walked with Cottrell around Tacoma Park in the 1950s and told him my problems with Adventist interpretation of prophecy, he had all the same problems. So he went to Elder Nichol, he said, what do we do? This one on 8:14, he said. None of our scholars believe it.
He said, none of our scholars believe this stuff.
Nichol said, write to all the scholars who know Hebrew and Greek.
Hebrew and Greek.
And ask them. All 27 came back and said, you can't prove an investigative judgment or an 1844.
Can't prove an investigative judgment.
Daniel 8:14.
Have we proven it this week?
So if you say to me, Des, you'd include in the church people who have all sorts of errors? Yes, because I love the Adventists. And I love the Catholics. And the Presbyterians. And the Plymouth Brethren. I will love any man or woman that loves Jesus. And that believes through Christ alone we can have eternal life. You know, hands
cool. This man can't take it.
Somewhat of a heretic.
Look at this church full of folks.
This is what he said about the church of the future.
Now that you have seen the clip, brothers and sisters, I suppose
all right, let me take you back. Don't pass out there. Don't pass out yet. Now, the question that you should have is, how can this man actually speak in our church and say such things as this? That would be the question I would have. How can that be? This man says everything that you and I, that Brother Davis and I have shared with you this week is all error. But have you seen it as true?
Yes.
He said, you can't. Listen, people say, how come we don't hear the church talk about the investigative judgment? Now I'm going to show you why you don't hear about it, our church talking about the investigative judgment. Are you ready?
Yes.
All right. Here we stand by Samuel Pippin. He says, among the Adventist doctrines that Dr. Ford opposes are sanctuary, 1844, the investigative judgment, the remnant church, and the role of the spirit of prophecy. In 1979, he publicly announced that he had not believed some of these doctrines for the past 35 years because he could not reconcile the writings of Ellen G. White with the book of Hebrews. Have we done that this week?
Yes.
We have done that. In 2002, Ford at last publicly admitted he did not believe in the creation of the world in 6 literal days. A few thousand years ago. Let's go. Are you ready?
Yes.
This is what he don't believe in. Now you read this part, saints. A staggering 180 ministers left in ministry within the next decade. Stop. Wait a minute. Ford was deflogged, and how many ministers left with him and within the next 10 years? 180 Seventh-day Adventist ministers left with him within 10 years because they believed the same thing that he believed. Now the question, wait a minute, how could Seventh-day Adventist ministers believe that? How could 180 ministers leave the church and follow Ford? Ministers that have been standing in the pulpit preaching to audiences just like this. How could this be? Let's continue reading. Main in the church. What? Wait a minute, 180 left, but most of them stayed in the church? All right, keep reading. Wait a minute, did the prophet say that our organization would be changed?
Yes.
Did she say this, brothers and sisters?
Yes.
Now, wait a minute. He left in 1980, 28 years later, he's back standing boldly like Satan when he came to heaven that time. Chest stuck out. All that we believe is error. And he's in the church at Loma Linda University. Teaching. And the ministers, the people, and listen, I have the full thing, that the stage is full of ministers before he gets up to speak. And nobody says a mumbling word. What does that tell you about those people? They all believe the same thing that he believes. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now I got a young couple here. They're gonna come up right quick here. Give us a quick, come on up. Where are they? Oh, right here, it is. Okay, I'm looking over here. I'm thinking I can't see for the light. Come up, my brother. Real quick, give him a mic. I want you to hear this, brothers and sisters. Give him a mic.
Good night, Sam.
Let me ask him a question. What's your name, sir?
Sonny Lafitu.
All right. And where do you live here in this area?
Yeah, I'm sure. I'm from Bahamas, but I'm at NCU right now.
You at where?
NCU.
And what are you studying at NCU?
Theology.
You are studying theology. Okay, good. All right. Would you tell me something about your theology that you're studying at? What's going on out there in your
school? Well, actually, when I first get to NCU as a freshman, my colleagues kept telling me, do you still believe in Ellen White? Do you still believe in the sanctuary message? Wait till you get to your third year.
Mm-hmm.
They kept saying, wait till you get to your third year. So, walking around campus, around my fellow students, theology students, I kept hearing the same thing. The sanctuary don't exist in heaven. The spirit of prophecy, Ellen White was not a prophet. So when I heard this, I started to study.
Mm-hmm.
I prayed and I study. So I'm like, hold on, this whole thing is in the Bible, I can see it.
Yes.
So how come those students are believing this? So every time I go home for the summer, I would show it to the people at my church.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so I started praying, I said, Lord, how come I'm seeing this in the Bible, but my fellow students are, you know, they all have the same mind. They don't believe in the spirit of prophecy. They do not believe on, I'm coming to it. It was not until I did a class called hermeneutics.
Uh-huh.
In this particular class, there's a method of Bible study called the historical critical method.
You better hear this!
Historical critical method. And in this particular class, in this particular professor, he is well known around Jamaica. This man... This, and I'm sitting in this class. I know, sometimes I say to myself, hold on. I know I am not the brightest person in the world. I know I'm not a genius. How come I'm sitting here, I'm listening to this man. I know this man is not a Seventh-day Adventist based on what he's saying. I'm going to give you an example. One time, well, he had a slide up that says that we cannot trust Ellen White because she makes mistakes. Just like any other prophet, she makes mistakes. Prophets are not Jesus Christ. I'm like, all right, prophets are not Jesus Christ. Then in another class, someone asked a question. They say, when Jesus said that there are some of you that stand here that will not see, that will not see, taste death and tell the citizens about come in power and glory. Uh-huh. Right? So someone asked, okay, what did Jesus mean by that? He said, Jesus was mistaken. Yes. So I'm like, hold on. First, you said that we cannot put prophets in the same platform as Jesus because Jesus did not make mistakes. Then you turn around and tell me Jesus was mistaken. Yes. I mean, if you're going to deceive me, I mean, you got to come correct. Right? Now, with this class, as I sit down and listen to this man, the psychological abuse that's going on in the class, like if you don't believe this, they look down on you. It's like you're not a scholar, you're unlearned. It's like the mindset is if you said anything about the spirit of prophecy or the sanctuary, you were laughed at. And these young men are coming to a church near you to preach. They are going to be your future pastors. I'm telling you, based on the historical critical method, and I study this thing.
The fifth generation will not run this church.
Go ahead, brother.
And you
And when I found out this, I said, I'm going to do a study in this thing. And I started to study the historical critical method. And I found out it coming from an atheist. No, the young ministers who are coming to your church do not believe on the Bible. Why do you think, I'm going to ask you this right now. When last you heard a sermon in your church where the minister went from pages to pages, line upon line, precept upon precept? When last? What they will do, this is what they will do. They'll take a passage, they'll read it, they'll give you 3 points, make you feel good, and you say amen, you go home, and they go to the conference and collect a paycheck. That's all they do. Because their conscience won't allow them to teach, to preach from certain text, because they don't believe in it.
Let me add this. And to get your theology degree, you can no longer use the proof text method that we've been using here this week. You can't do that. That's not
scholarly. You cannot do that. If you do that, they look at you as unlearned. And as I said, and I'm not even going to get on what's going on around campus. And I know you might have heard some of it. Let me give an example. Last semester, I had a friend who was scared for his life because he was staying on dorm. And the guy he was staying with, while he was in the room, he caught the guy laying in bed with the next guy. So he videotaped them. He said, I'm so scared for my life. I want you to do this because he reported it, right? And he said, I don't know what's going to happen. Here's the video. Hold it for me just in case anything happened and you can show it to people. And this guy, when he caught in bed with the other guy, is our ambassador. Was our ambassador. And this is what's going on. There's this movement on campus right now where homosexuals is taking over campus. And there's nothing the school can do about it. Students are wearing jewelry, and the school can't do anything about it. They are wearing tights, which the book said they can't do. And I'm pretty sure Elder Mason and Pastor Davis will tell you the reason why they cannot do any, they cannot enforce their laws, because as Ellen White gave us a blueprint of how we operate our schools, but we leave it. NCU went to the government for money. Based on that, they cannot, that the government would have to tell them how to run the school. They cannot enforce the school protocols and rules. So this is what's going on around campus right now. And as I said before, that the majority, and I'm telling you right now, over the years, I have friends, and I keep emphasizing this, like when you see these young people, do not get mad at them. This is not a fight against people. We fight not against flesh and blood. I have friends who I see as they come humble, just they want to preach the gospel. They want to, just like I was when I first got converted, I want to tell everybody about the mark of the beast. These kids, they come as freshmen. They're excited. You give them a semester or two.
And they go.
They want to be scholars, counselors, anything but being ministers, because their conscience won't allow them to preach from this. They don't believe in the Bible, and this is what they learned from this class called hermeneutics. And there's a systematic way that they are doing. First of all, the class called hermeneutics, where they say that you cannot use precept upon precept, line upon line. Second of all, in homiletics, the class where they teach you how to preach, they said the only method they teach you is the expository, when you take a scripture and you expound on it, you get your 3 points, and that's it. So it's hard for you. I would say it's hard. It's hard for you to teach the doctrine of this church without going through the Bible, page to page, precept upon precept. So it's a systematic way that they are using to kill this whole message of the three angels message.
All right, my brother. Brother and sister. Saints, do you understand? All right, we need your attention. I know this is very stirring. Let's have a word of prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, we understand that we are wrestling against the devil himself. And the prophet have already told us that his most effective means would be through the educational system. Dear God, we know that we're at the end. We're at the very end. We are here. Lord, we have seen it. You blessed us this week to pull all of this out. Lord, it's time for us to go to the kingdom. Lord, there's still so much to share, so much to share. But Lord, I ask your blessing upon each and every one of us, and particularly this group here in Jamaica, Lord, that they will not become discouraged, but they will be encouraged. And Lord, that they will seek to understand your word like never before, so they can be a part of your team to finish this work. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, saints, I need about another 15, 20 minutes. Can I get it? Because I want to show you why. You need to know why. So listen, I'm going to try to rush through it as quick as I can to get to the point where I need to be. All right, let's go. What does the prophet say? She says, the light has been given me, that tremendous pressures will be brought upon every Seventh-day Adventist with whom the world can get into close connection. Those who seek the education that the world esteems so highly are what? Gradually led further and further from the principle of truth until they become?
Educated.
At what a price have they gained their education? They have parted with the Holy Spirit of God. They have chosen to accept what the world calls knowledge in the place of the truths which God has committed to men through his ministers and prophets and apostles. Have you just seen that demonstration, say? All right, let's go. And there are some who haven't secured this worldly education, think that they can introduce it into our schools. But let me tell you that you must not take what the world calls the and bring it into our and churches. We need to understand these things. I speak to you definitely. This must not be done. Now, the reason I pressed you so hard last night on the French Revolution and this Illuminism, because it's in our schools, it's in the whole world now. Satan is ruling the whole world through Illuminism. Let's go. She says, listen, saints, false education system that produces terror. She says, shall we not be doers of the words of him who knows all things? Shall we not make the Bible the man of our counsel in the education and training of our youth? The word of God is the foundation of all true knowledge. And Christ teaches what men must do in order to be saved. Hitherto, the designs of the enemy have been carried out in bringing before our students what? Such books as have taught specious errors, such as philosophy, evolution, stands faith up, psychology, Voltaire, James Jacob Rousseau. That's what the students are studying. They're linking their mind with atheism and this foolishness, and then they're coming out and being professors and pastors and leaders in our church. That's the reason I tell you, brothers and sisters, that the fifth generation of Seventh-day Adventists will never become the movers and shakers. Can't happen. Look at here. And presented fables that have tempted their carnal appetites. Look what she says. Let's read it. Shall we bring into our schools the sower of tares? And the enemy has done this. He has sowed tares in God's church through the educational system, brothers and sisters. Shall we permit men who are called great and yet who have been taught by the enemy of truth to have the education of our youth? Did you just see that? Brothers and sisters, that's exactly what Satan has done. Or shall we take the word of God as our guide and have our schools conducted more after the order of the ancient schools of the prophets? Yes. Brothers and sisters, there's so much here. Let me go. The tempter has his agents educated according to his methods. That's what these students are under. They're under Satan's agents, educated according to his methods. Inspired by his spirit and adapted to his work. Shall we cooperate with them? Shall we receive the works of his agents as essential to the acquirement of an education? Who can bring a clean thing out of an unclean? Not one. Can we then expect the youth to maintain Christian principles and to develop Christian character while their education is largely influenced by the teachings of what? Pagans, atheists, and infidels. Not going to happen, brothers and sisters. That's the reason, brothers and sisters, it was not safe for John the Baptist to attend the schools of his day, and saints, it's not safe to attend the schools of this day. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Let's go. The mastermind in the confederacy of evil is ever working to keep out of sight the words of God and to bring into full view the opinions of men. He means that we should not hear the voice of God saying, this is the way, walk you in it. Through educational processes, he is doing all in his power to obscure heaven's light. Brothers and sisters, now I'm skipping over a whole lot because you got to understand why we did what we did in 1931. But in 1931, we were pressured to accredit three of our schools because in 1912, we were, McGann, all I can say is he gave in. And he pushed for Loma Linda to become accredited. And then when we were sending our students to Loma Linda to be medical missionaries or be medical practitioners or what have you, the AMA told us we could no longer send students from our non-accredited schools to this accredited school. See, we should have never accredited Loma Linda. Ellen G. White stood up against it, but we did it. And so then the accrediting institution forced us to accredit the rest of our schools, at least three in 1931, 32, in order to be able to send these students to Loma Linda. So we would, listen, Satan reeled us in. So in 1931, Emmanuel Missionary College, Pacific Union College, and Walla Walla College was forced. Elder H.H. Baltimore cried aloud, we are preparing, listen, Saints, read it. We are preparing to send our boys to hell in three of our schools. He says, if accrediting is wrong, it is altogether wrong, referring to only Emmanuel Missionary College, Pacific Union College, and Walla Walla College, where it was initially decided to have accreditation. In 1931, Elder J.L. Mahaney said, we will see the day when we will rule, or we will regret what we have done. And we are, brothers and sisters, you and I are seeing that day right now. Right now. Now listen, brothers and sisters, listen to this thing, saints. By 1940, all of our schools were accredited. But something else more happened in 1940. Now listen, saints, it takes only 20 years for a false education system to completely turn an institution around. It takes only 4 years for a pastor with this false education to change a church around. Are you with me, saint?
Yes.
4 years he can change a church and shut down anybody that will stand up against it.
Yes.
Watch this now, saints. Look here. There's 1,200 statements by the pioneers of this church that says Jesus came in the nature of Adam's fallen nature. 1,200 statements. 400 statements by Ellen G. White herself, 800 by the other pioneers. Are you with me, saints? You know who this man is? M. L. Andreessen. He was one of the last men that was standing for this truth all the way. He wrote a book called The Sanctuary Series. Look what he says. He says the found demonstration of what the gospel can do in and for humanity is still in the future. This is what we've been teaching this week. Christ showed the way. He took a human body and in that body demonstrated the power of God. Men are to follow his example and prove that what God did in Christ, he can do in every human being who submits. We've gone through this, right? The world is awaiting this demonstration. The Bible says that the whole earth is moaning and groaning, wanting to be delivered, waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. The whole earth wants to be delivered from this curse of sin. Look here, saints. He says, when it has been accomplished, let's read that part together, saints. When it has been accomplished, what will happen? The end will come. God will have fulfilled his plan. He will have shown himself true and Satan a liar. His government will stand vindicated. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Now, saints, the pioneers believed this. They taught this. Are you hearing me, saints? Now, watch it. Are you ready? Watch it. Were this reformation to take place, we find out what would the result. The principle of truth that God and his wisdom has given to the Roman church would be discarded. Our religion would be changed. The fundamental principles that have sustained the work for the last 50 years would be a kind of error. A new organization would be established. Books of a new order would be written. A system of intellectual philosophy. Did you just hear it?
Yes.
A system of intellectual philosophy would be introduced. The founders of the system would go into the cities and do a wonderful work. The Sabbath, of course, would be lightly regarded as also the God who created it. Nothing would be allowed to stand in the way of the new movement, et cetera, et cetera. I'm going to move on. Here we have M. Elder Driessen on the left. Field Secretary of the General Conference, 1941 to 1950, taught at the Seventh-day Adventist Theological Seminary, now located at Andrews University from 1937 to 1949, and was recognized as a leading denominational scholar on the atonement and related topics, just what we've been talking about. Yes. Are you with me, saying? Yes. On our right, who do we have on our right? Yes. Professor of Systematic Theology, 1950 to 1970, what's his name? Everett E. Heppenstall. His presentations on the law and covenants at the 1952 Bible Conference were highly influential upon the theology of the church. Let's read it. Heppenstall was responsible for in the understanding of the church's investigative judgment teaching. Are you with me, saints? So who is Heppenstall? Where was he educated? Let's see. There's the shift. His presentation on the law and covenants at the 1952 Bible Conference were highly influential upon the theology of the church. Heppenstall was responsible for a shift in the understanding of the church's investigative judgment teaching. Heppenstall, let's read it, saints, was the most influential scholar to come out against M. Elder Driessen. He was the most influential to come out against M. Elder Driessen. What else? Hold on. Against M. Elder Driessen and theology, while upholding the pillars of doctrine of the Adventist pioneers, he opposed Andreessen's form of what? Historic Adventism on such issues as the human nature of Christ. Now listen, saints, have we gone through this today? I mean, this week we've gone through this. Jesus came in the fallen nature of Adam. The prophet makes 400 statements on this. Not one, not two, 400. The pioneers made 800. But this man here says no, a scholar. On such issues as the human nature of Christ and the atonement, he emphasized, as did, you ever heard of that book? Let me see the hands of you have heard of the book, Question on Doctrine. Oh, we in trouble in here. Oh, saints, we are in trouble. I'm telling you, we were saints. We were brought into this church in Babylonian captivity. You ain't heard of the book Question on Doctrine? Oh, Lord have mercy. Yes. Listen to what he says. The atonement on the cross with a continuing ministry in heaven in the antitypical day of atonement. Beyond that, he stressed such teachings as what? The helplessness of human beings to do good of their own selves, justification by faith in relationship to the entire plan of salvation, the impossibility of humanly achieving what some people think of as sinless perfection. It says impossible. The fact that Jesus was not just like other children of fallen Adam and the new covenant experience, Heppenstall theology was definitely a more what? Cross-centered, Christ-centered, evangelical form of theology. This plainly shows up in Heppenstall's understanding of character perfection, far from ideas of sinlessness, perfectionism, the teaching that people must get to the place where they can stand without Christ and other ideas set forth by Driessen. He argued that nowhere does the Bible equate perfection with sinlessness when speaking of the child of God. So they say, no, you can't overcome sin. He says, you will be coming sinning until Jesus comes. That's what he said. Now guess what? He had a protege.
Guess what his protege was named? Desmond Ford. Now you know why Desmond Ford believed as he believed. Now you know his protege was Desmond Ford. He taught Desmond Ford. Listen, let's read it, Saints. Edward Heppenstall earned a BA degree where? Major in English, literature, and also doing work in science and theology. Then what? He got a master's degree from where? Babylon in history and semantics. While teaching at where? He earned a PhD degree in the field of religious education from what? Babylon. Then he brings this stuff into the Adventist church and say you can't overcome sin. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Did the prophet say this was going to happen? She says you must not take what the world calls the higher education and bring it into our churches and our schools and our sanitarium. She says, I speak to you definitely, this must not be done. Now listen, brothers and sisters, we just began a credit in 1932. 1952, you see where we are. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? 20 years later, you see where we are. Let's go. Don Gray Barnhouse, you ever heard of this man?
Yes.
You ever heard of Walter Maher?
Yes.
Now, I can't go into all the details, but I'm going to tell you what you ought to do. Let me tell you what you all ought to do. You ought to get a book called The Evangelical Earthquake. How many of you have heard the name?
Yes.
Now, listen, Saint, all of you, can band together and get you a couple cases of those books. You can get them from me, or you can get them from, Harvest Time Books. Because you can get a whole case of 60 books for $35. A whole case of 60 for $35. You have to pay for the shipping now. I don't know what the shipping will be down here. Because we're trying to make money, and we're trying to get the money and stuff in people's hands. So you can get a case of 60 books for $35. And you ought to get them, and you ought to sit down, every one of you, and read it. You ought to have studies on it. You also need to get the book. You ever heard of the book Broken Blueprint?
Yes.
Then if you need to get that book, you need to get your two or three cases so everybody got one. You can get that book for probably like 50 or 60 cents a piece. And so you ought to band together and get enough so it all, this is where you need to start your studies. Are you with me, Saints? All right, look here. Here is the book that those people forced us to write. I can't get into all the details. You need to get the evangelical quick and read it. We were forced to write a book called Questions on Doctrine because when Martin Barnhouse was going to write a book on the cults, they were going to make us a cult. They said, well, listen, let's go over and talk to them first. Because T.E. Unruh had reached out to Barnhouse early on as he listened to him on the radio talking about righteousness by faith, and T.E. Unruh, which was a president of the Eastern Conference up there somewhere, and Barnhouse rejected him, even calling him, writing him, said, you don't know, you are Seventh-day Adventist, you don't know about no righteousness by faith. But when they got ready to write this book on the cults, they was going to make Seventh-day Adventists one of the cults in this book. So I said, let's go over and talk to those Adventists first. So they went over and talked to them and said, do you believe this? And the Adventists said, no, we don't believe that. They asked him a pointed question, do you believe that Sunday has anything to do with the mark of the beast? And we said, no, we don't believe that. Now, Martin was very smart, so Martin had already been by a bookstore and bought a book called Mark of the Beast. He had read it. He said, if you don't believe that the sun has anything to do with the Mark of the Beast, he said, what is this book that was in your bookstore? Their reply, Anderson and Froome, was, well, you know, in every religious organization, there are some fanatics. Fringes, that's what it is. He said, some wide-eyed lunatics. He said, so some wide-eyed lunatic got in print, but we as a religious, as a group, do not believe that sin has anything to do with the mark of the beast. And so they started talking to him about the atonement and all these different things and having what nature Christ came in, and we were denying everything that we believe. And so they says, okay, if you really believe this, then write a book. So put it, make an official book that you say you believe this. And so we wrote a book. That's a long story. It's not that simple, but I'm going to tell you what's in the book. Let me show you what's in the book. In the book it says, Christ took the sinless human nature of Jesus. That's on page 605. When the incarnate God
broke into human history and became one with the race, it is our understanding that he possessed the sinless of the nature with which Adam was created in Eden. That right there destroys Adventism. That destroys the cleansing of the sanctuary. That destroys it. Are you with me, brother and sister? Did the prophet say books of a new order would be written?
Yes, sir.
Did she say that?
Yes.
Did she say system of intellectual philosophy would be introduced? Did she say that?
Yes.
Was this, is this part of the Omega?
Yes.
Look what the prophet said. Christ assumed our fallenness. Who you going to believe? You going to believe questions on doctrine? Or are you going to believe Ellen G. White? Brothers, now she didn't just make one. She made 400 statements. And the pioneers made 800 statements prior to 1952. So brothers and sisters, the shift in the belief of the Seventh-day Adventist Church took place in 1952. What generation was that? Come on, talk to me, saints. This was the third generation. Are you with me, saints? The shift took place in 1952. I was 7 years old at the time. Are you with me, saints? So before you and I ever came in this church, the shift had already been, the juice had already been watered down. When they gave me the juice in 1976, I guffed it down. Oh, yeah, this is good stuff. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? Look here. Let's go. As they were writing this book, they began to send out excerpts from the book to the scholars in the church. And they sent us, Anderson sent some over to Australia, and a guy in Australia wrote back and said, listen, are y'all trying to change our doctrines? And Anderson wrote him back. Let's read it. Anderson wrote him back and said, yes, we are trying to change the doctrines, but we want to take it to the ministry before we go to the people with it. Are you hearing this, brothers and sisters?
Yes.
What did the prophet say? Our religion would be changed in the Omega of apostasy. Are you with me, saints? Let's go. While this was going on, back then this man was the Billy Graham of the era at that time. So while this was going on, we were out proselyting, we were giving Bible studies, and some young girl was embracing Adventism at the time. So the family wrote to Barnhouse and said, listen, our child is about to join this cult, the Seventh-day Adventist. What can we do? And this is what Anderson wrote him back. He then told the girl's parents that he and Dr. Martin were working to bring Seventh-day Adventists into harmony with evangelical Protestantism by actually changing their doctrines. And he encouraged the couple with the assurance that he and Mr. Martin were succeeding. Are you with me, brothers? Look what she says. What the prophet says is going to happen. The principles of truth that God in his wisdom has given to the remnant of the church would be discarded. This is the omega of apostasy. Let's go. Now, we're going to move fast. I'm trying to get some play. Outstretched hands. In 1962, the Catholic Church came up with two in order to bring all the Protestants back to Rome. Are you hearing me, saints? They said, listen, up until 1962, they've been calling us heretics. And so they said, listen, we're changing. We're going to have Vatican II. And see, now Vatican I was a meeting that they held to fight the Reformation. But Vatican II, well, was a counter-Reformation. So, but Vatican II was to bring all the churches back under one head. And they said, look, we want all y'all to come to Rome, let you know that we love you, and we're not going to call you heretics no more. We're going to call you separated brethren. We love you. Are you with me? So they invited all the Protestants all over the world to come. And we went. You know that man right there? You know that right there? That's Bible study. Who wrote that book?
Maxwell.
Arthur Maxwell. He went, and when he came back, that's what he said. He said, first, the friendliness of their welcome. You see, I've been there several times. That is to Rome. He said it was always a sort of an iciness there. So he said, I've been there before then. He said it was always kind of an iciness there. He says, but not anymore. Not anymore. And it was evidenced in so many ways. For instance, in the giving of these press passes, Brother Loing was there from Religious Liberty. Brother Cottrell, remember that name, was from the Review. And Harold, Brother Beach was there from Northern Europe. Remember that name? And I, Arthur Maxwell, was there from the science. And provided you had a good reason for asking for a pass, you got it. If you were an editor or a correspondent for a real newspaper, they gave the pass. And they gave them to people of all faiths. Here, four Adventists got these passes. I thought you would like to see mine. Listen to what he says. It's the only document I have which has the cross, keys, and the triple crown on it. What's the triple crown? Yeah. In other words, what does the triple crown represent? King of heaven, the earth, and beneath. So this, here's a Seventh-day Adventist. It's saying, man, I have a pass with the triple crown on it, and he's happy about it. He says, I have to be careful when I show this. I don't want anybody to think I'm going over to the Church of Rome, but it is a very nice little pass, and it was very valuable. This little pass got me anywhere I wanted to go at the time of the council. Let's move on with him. There's the people that was there. I don't have a picture of Brother Lauren. He says, then another aspect of the friendliness, the way they arranged for the press of the world to have the best seats at the opening ceremony. Let's read this part. I sat closer to the Pope than any of the cardinals. He says, look what he says. Look what he says, Saint. Let's read it. I was only 40 feet away from him for 3 or 4 hours. He said, I was only 40 feet from him. Listen to what he said. He says, and I had the clearest view, just as clear as some of you, 40 feet away. Look what he says. Let's read it. The reason I know he was 40 feet away, I stepped it out after the service was over because I thought nobody will ever believe me that I sat so long, so near to His Holiness. Brothers and sisters, by this time, a change is taking place. You got to understand what's going on. You got to understand what's going on here. A metamorphosis is taking place among us by this time. See, this is 1965. This is 30-some years later. So it's been a gradual, remember she says he's watering this message down gradually? So it's been a metamorphosis taking place. Look what he says. He says, but I had a wonderful view, and I saw some most fascinating close-up views, which I won't tell you now. Let's skip on. Let's go. Maxwell followed this with some advice to ministers and telling what he had already done. He said, now, there's one other thing. These things are going to make us think. They really are. This new situation. He said, this is a new situation. He says, I think that a lot of our preachers are going to have to throw away a lot of old sermons. He says, the Seventh-day Adventists have to throw away these sermons calling these people the beasts. He says, we got to stop calling these people the beasts. They're not the beasts. Look what he said. He says, you and me, a lot of old sermons, I scrapped a lot of them already. You know what I think is going to happen. We cannot go on preaching about these dear people like we did 30, 40, 50 years ago. We simply can't do it. The facts are all against us. How can we go and talk about them persecuting, burning the Bible when they're not doing anything of the sort? We've just got to get some new sermons. These people are no longer the beasts. So we got to get some new sermons. Rome never changes. But Brother Maxwell, listen, I'm not beating him down or nothing, saints. He just simply was mesmerized. You can go to the, look, I got the source right there. What did I do with it? Wait a minute, let me back it up. I put it up there somewhere. There it is right there. No, yeah, that's at Loma Linda. Let's go put in an outstretched hand, University Church of Loma Linda, California, outstretched hand. Go to the web and you'll get it. All right, let's go. This is where he spoke at. All right, let's go, saints. I'm trying to get there. I'm just trying to get to a point, saints. Give me just a little bit more time. I got to get to a certain point here. You got to get this. You see that? You see that? You see that? That's what we believe. This is what came out of the Protestant Reformation. I mean, when the Counter-Reformation. The Catholic Church came up with futurism and predatism as a means of understanding the Bible. Predatism means past in fulfillment. Futurism means future in fulfillment. And this means past, present, and future. Now, what the Catholic Church was doing, they was trying to throw the light off of them because the Bible was pinpointing them as the beast. And all the Protestant people were saying they are the beast, and they were proving it from the Bible. So they came up with a new interpretation, all right? Creditism is a Christian eschatology view that interprets prophecies of the Bible as events which have already happened. Daniel is interpreted as events that happened in the 2nd century BC, while Revelation is interpreted as events that happened in the 1st century AD. In other words, they said all the Revelation has already been fulfilled. The only thing that's left is the last three chapters. In other words, that throws the light off of them as being the beast of Revelation 13 and all of that. And so Preterism began the way to understand the Bible. They pushed it. Now let's see, where did it come from? Where did this come from? He is known for his, I don't know how to pronounce it, that's Spanish, published after his death, putting forward what would later be called a what? Preterist view of biblical prophecy. In commentary on the book of Revelation, his work is regarded as the first major application of the method of interpretation of prophecy by reading in terms of the author's contemporary concerns. Look at the next statement now. His view was that everything in Apocalypse, apart from the three final chapters, refers to events that have already come to pass. The book's illustrations were after Juan D. Somebody, who produced a series of 24 designs on the Apocalypse. I'm going to the next one. This man's right, came up with the method. And he was trying to defend the Catholic Church. All right? His view was that everything in the Apocalypse, apart from the three final chapters, refers to events that already have come to pass. That's the preterist view of biblical prophecy. Now, here's the part we want to see. There has historically been general agreement with non-preterists that the first systematic preterist exposition of prophecy was written by the Jesuit. Who is he? Louis D. Alcazar. During the Counter-Reformation, Moses Stuart noted that Alcazar's preterist interpretation was of considerable benefit to the Roman Catholic Church during its arguments with who? And preterism has been described in modern eschatological commentary as a what, saints? A Catholic defense against a Protestant historicist view which identified the Roman Catholic Church as a persecuting apostasy. Look at the next statement, saints. Due to resistance by Protestant historicists, the preterist view was slow to gain acceptance outside the Roman Catholic Church. Read the next part together. Among Protestants, it was first accepted by Hugo Grotius. What was he? A Dutch Protestant eager to establish common ground. Let's set it together. Eager to establish common ground between Protestants and the Roman Catholic Church. So what was he eager to do? Common ground between the Protestants and the Roman Catholic Church. All right, let's go. Who is this man? Tell me who he is. John McKay Pauline is who? A Seventh-day Adventist theologian specializing in the study of books by John in the New Testament. He was a professor of New Testament interpretation at Andrews University. What does he believe? What does he teach? Let's see what he teaches. Journal of the Adventist Theological Society. He calls it the end of historicism. That's what we believe. That's what we've been teaching all week. We've been teaching historicism. That's what the Bible teaches. Are you with me, saying? Look what he says. Alternative approaches. He says, listen to this man now. This is a Seventh-day Adventist. Look what he says. He says, one, preterism. A number of SDA thinkers, particularly, you read it, those educated in religion and history, have seen increasing light in the preterist approach to biblical apocalypse. Look here. This approach, the primary one among what? Professional biblical scholars, I'm glad I'm not a professional biblical scholar, treats books like Daniel and the Revelation as messages to their original time and place, not as divinely ordained chains of future historical events. Brothers, this is what we've been teaching this week, is historical chains of events. That's the proof text method. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? But this man is saying, that's not good. That's what this brother was saying earlier. You can't use that in the schools no more. According to this approach, believers benefit from these books not by seeing where they stand in the course of history, but by applying spiritual principles drawn from the text to the latest situation. Saints, we in trouble. Preterists. Journal of the Adventist Theological Society. So now, when we look at the next slide, this man here, who was the first Adventist to become a member of a scholar of theological society and was instrumental in the founding of the Biblical Research Institute. He was an associate editor of the SDA commentary. Now, you remember, the man talked about him. Look what he says. He says, the traditional Adventist interpretation of Daniel 8:14 was formulated on the basis of what is commonly known as the proof text method of Bible study. Now, this man wrote your commentary. This is, you know what your commentary is? Yes. This man was the editor of your commentaries. He says, which construes Bible passages in terms of what a modern reader thinks to be their import. This method is highly subjective, understands the Bible from the modern reader's cultural, historical, and salvation history perspective, accepts the Bible and translation as authoritative. Did you get that? He said, accepts the Bible and translation as authoritative. Makes the reader's personal and group think presupposition normative for evaluating data and for drawing conclusions. This method does not require special training or experience, yes, and is followed by a majority of untutored Bible readers. I'm an untutored Bible reader, praise God. The Holy Spirit taught me. Since the beginning, listen, you read it. Since the beginning, most Adventists have followed this method, but no reputable Bible scholars follows it today. But no reputable Bible scholar follows it today. Proof text method. Don't. When Daniel 8:14 is studied by the historical, now he's talking about historical, not historicism, serious flaws in the traditional interpretation becomes apparent because the historical method, one, aspires to be as objective as possible, endeavors to understand the Bible as the various writers intended what they wrote to be understood, and as their original reading audience would have understood it from their cultural, historical, and salvation. This is a bunch of Google, I'll tell you that right now. Considers words, literary forms, and statements according to their meaning in their original language, are normative, endeavors to evaluate data objectively, and bases its conclusions on the weight of the evidence. Let's read this part. This method requires either special training in biblical languages and the history and milieu of antiquity, or reliance on source materials prepared by persons with such training. Read it. Since about 1940, most Adventist Bible scholars have followed this method. Brothers and sisters, since 1940, I wasn't even born. We had already gone into Babylonian captivity way back then. And so we're wondering why this is going on in our church today. Don't you see why? Brothers and sisters, Satan has slept this thing in on us before, and we didn't even know it. A system of intellectual philosophy being introduced. I'm going to move on. I'm going to move real quick now. Out of the Vatican II, this is the King James Bible. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption. NIV. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the what? So the Bible, the NIV says Jesus left the earth and went straight to the most holy.
Yes.
Brother, do you understand what that means?
Yes.
That's do away with Adventism right there. And that NIV is all we get now. You can't even get a King James Bible. It's in the quarterly. I'm moving, saints. I'm moving real quick. I want to get to one more place. Neil Wilson, the father of our president now, look what he says. Although it is true that there was a period in the life of the Seventh-day Adventist Church when the denomination took a distinctly anti-Roman Catholic viewpoint, that attitude on the church's part was nothing more than a manifestation of widespread anti-popery among conservative Protestant denominations in the early part of this century and the latter part of the last, and which has now been consigned to the historical trash sheet. So he said, we no longer believe that. We don't believe that no more. The Catholics are good people. 1977, B.B. Beach, who went to Rome, gave to the Pope a gold medal. Although astonishing, it is true, in 1977, the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists presented a gold medallion to Pope Paul VI as an expression of what? Of a close friendship with the Papal States. We are friends with the beast. Look at it, saints. Here is B.B. Beach. Beach's encounter with the Roman Pontiff came as a member of the Christian World Communion and as and follows a special luncheon at the Vatican. Review November 8, 2001. Note the Seventh-day Adventist Church is a member. Look what it says, what the prophet said. What she said. It is a backsliding church that lessens the distance between itself and the papacy. John Paul II greets his friend, Vert B. Beach. What are we doing? Saints, these people are under the spell of the devil. Let's go. This is my last slide right here. That's where I wanted to get. I want you to read it. This is my last slide. We're coming to a close. At the 1990 General Conference session in Indianapolis, a Catholic priest spoke and prayed from the pulpit. In other words, we sent to the Vatican and asked them to send a representative to open up our General Conference session. The conference communication director told a local newspaper that we no longer believe what we did 100 years ago concerning comments in the what? What? We no longer believe that? About the papacy. A condensation of the great controversy was handed out in Indianapolis. Shirley Burden, at that time, a spokesperson for the denomination, told the Indianapolis Star daily newspaper that track was trash. Now, I was there. I got the newspaper. She says, look what she says. The main body of the church has moved away from an anti-Catholic position. What is it? The new position of cooperation with the Catholic Church was exemplified by the invitation from Seventh-day Adventists to the Vatican to send an official observer to the conference. What? Look what it says. Though Adventist officials conceded the history of the denomination has an anti-Catholic bent, they said the modern church is trying to move from that stance. They, the dissidents, want us to be like we were 100 years ago, said Herbert Ford, news director for the 6.2 million member church. That's all we had then. But the church has to move not away from the eternal principle of God, but things do have to change. You read this part. These people are a thorn in the flesh. So anybody that believes in the great controversy and what the prophet said about the Catholic Church, they said we are a thorn in the flesh to the church. But look what the church is going to do for you. But what? But the church tolerates them. United States in prophecy, great controversy, which was sponsored by Adventist lay workers affiliated of Tennessee, calls Catholicism a pagan religion. Is it a pagan religion?
Yes.
And refers to the Pope as a beast. Is he the beast?
Yes.
Adventists who want to cling to this church's historic anti-Catholic beliefs represents only about 1,000 in the North American division of 750,000 members, Ford said. Brothers and sisters, yeah, that is true. Brothers and sisters, what we're simply saying here, 5 years later, the logo was changed. I already showed you that, so I'm not going back there. 5 years later, the logo was changed. The message that we have as a people has been changed. Now, saints, the prophet said this was going to happen. Did she say this was going to happen? So we shouldn't leave out of here upset. We should leave out of here prayerful. At the beginning, I told you this is God's church. Do you believe this is God's church?
Yes.
Enfeebled and defective, in need of reproof, it is still the only object upon this earth in which God bestows his supreme regard. These are the abominations that Ezekiel was seeing. When we take it and break it out into modern times, these are the abominations. God is showing Ezekiel, look what they're doing. They're giving the Pope a gold medal. They say there's not the beast anymore. That's what Ezekiel is saying. Look what they're doing. But we still have not kept Sunday yet. Are you with me saying? Now, we're on a road to do that if we don't get a valid connection with Christ. Are you with me saying? So what do we need to do as we bring this meeting to a close? What do we need to do, saint? We need to pray, don't we? We need to fast and pray. Do we need to study?
Yes.
Brothers and sisters, we need to study like we never studied before. We need to ask God for directions. Don't the rest of your friends and brothers and sisters on this island need to know this? To give this message. So we need to ask God, Lord, how can I take this message and give it to my brothers and sisters on this island? Don't we need to do that? We need to do that, brothers and sisters. We need to reach as many of God's people as we possibly can so that God's going to have a team. God's going to have a team.
But we want to do all we can to get as many on this team as we possibly can, saints. Jesus is getting ready, saints. The God the Father is rising up off of his throne. He can't stand the sins that's taking place in this world any longer. Jesus is saying, hold, hold, hold. Give my people a chance to receive the seal of God. When we take all that we've done this week and capsule it into one little thing, we need a relationship with Jesus that will enable us to stand when the investigated judgment passes from the dead to the living. That's what it comes down to, brothers and sisters. We need to understand the historic truth that God gave this church from the very beginning. Now I want to say one more time. The fifth generation of Seventh-day Adventists will come on the scene by 2024. I want to say that these people will not run this church. You can see why, can't you? If this fifth generation becomes the movement, what will they teach? What will they teach, saints? They won't have nothing to teach. There won't be no Adventism left. Are you with me, saints? Now, I'm not saying Jesus is coming in 2024. Don't leave here and say, Brother Mason said Jesus is coming in 2024. I just said that the fifth generation will begin to become that impact the church in 2024. Are you with me? And brother and sister, do you know how long that is down the road? That's 10 years down the road. Can you imagine what this world would be in 10 years? I don't believe we have 10 years. I'm going to be honest with you. Based on what we've studied this week, I don't believe we have 10 years. But again, we're not going to set time. What we're going to do is say, as I put in my newsletters, get ready. Get ready. Get ready. That's what we need to do. With that, let us have a word of prayer.